I appreciate the Lord and His faithfulness. And I was talking to Toyetta this morning. They live a long way now from the church. It's a long distance, and financially it's a real struggle for them to come here because of the distance and because of the limited finances. But she said the last three Sunday mornings, Hadim has been up and ready for church before she ever got up. And when she got up, he said, "Mom, are we going to Bethel today?" You know, and he just keeps encouraging. You know, God's really working in his life. And he's really doing something. And it's a real sacrifice for them to get here and to be here at church. But God's really working in his life. And we were talking in my Sunday school class today about once God has delivered you, so important to stay free.
Yes.
It's so important to stay free.
Right.
It's so dangerous to play with the things of God. It's so foolish to play with the things of God.
Yes, it is.
And if you've been delivered from something, you need to stay free of it. Whatever it takes, whatever you have to do, you stay free of whatever it is that God has delivered you from. Because your deliverance is for a lifetime. Unless you just foolishly, deliberately walk back into it. You don't have to do that. You can be free. And I don't know, but all over this building today, there are days that you can point to that God gave you freedom from something. Whether it was an addiction, whether it was a hurt or a situation in your life or brokenness, you can point to that day that God set you free. That He brought you out of that. And I don't know about you, but I have no desire to go back.
No.
I said, I don't know about you. But I have no desire to go back.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Do you remember when you became free? Do you remember? Could you tell me when it was that you gained freedom? Hallelujah.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but I
do. Yes.
I don't ever want to go back.
No.
Not one thing that God brought freedom in my life. And you all know this song. We haven't sang it in a while, Katrina, I think. I don't remember who sings on it. But let's sing out. Go back.
Thank you.
Amen. I mean, I know that's graphic, but you know what? Man, you think about how horrible that is. And why would we ever want to go back to a life of sin, right? Amen. Praise God. Why would we want to be entangled again with the yoke of bondage? Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Grab your Bibles, if you would, and turn with me to the book of John and the Gospel of John, chapter 5. We're going to read there for just a few verses tonight and trust that we can preach to you tonight, all right? Hallelujah. And this is the story in the book of John, chapter 5. Man, such an exciting story. And something that always just kind of fascinated me, and that probably has fascinated you as well. Amen. But I'd like to see the Lord provide help, if I touch somebody. I'd like to be leaving here tonight and talk about how somebody needs to help. And somebody got to touch, all right? Touch the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Chapter 5 and verse 1. After this there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of infirm folk, a blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lie, and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? Then the man answered him, and said, Sir, I have no man, when the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. And Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, It is the Sabbath day. It is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. He answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, What man is that which saith unto thee, Take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. Afterward Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. The man departed and told the Jews, and it was Jesus which had made him whole.
Amen.
Amen. I think this is an interesting story of the Pool of Bethesda, and it's kind of fascinating that there was even such a place, right, in Jerusalem. And recently they found, it's not been that recent, but in the last century, the 1900s, I believe around 1960s, they found, that seems like a long time ago, but that's when I was born. Archaeologists found what they believed was the Pool of Bethesda. And they had found and located this. And it actually was like, when you think of five porches, you know, they think, well, how would it, what kind of a shape would, you know, a pool with five porches have to be? Would it, you know? And what it basically was really just two pools put together with a porch on each side of it, and one, a porch separating those two pools. But it's kind of interesting to read that they did locate that pool of Bethesda. And you know, the Bible has been proved true over and over and over and over again. And as archaeology and science has proved the Bible to be true many, many times. But I want you to notice a few things here. They said this was called Bethesda, which a house of mercy, or mercy's house, if you will.
Right.
It's a place, and surely it was the mercy of God. I think it's interesting that at this time that when we read these verses, I can't question or I don't doubt what is in the Bible, all right? That the Bible tells us that an angel of the Lord come down, and an angel came down and troubled the waters, all right? And then whosoever was the first in would be healed. I think that probably this, if you think about this, it was a time nobody knew when, was not on any set time that an angel would come down and trouble the water. It wasn't that you couldn't set your clock by it. If that would have been the case, they would have all been right at the edge, ready to fall in a moment that the water was troubled. It wasn't something that was predictable. It was just at a whim, at a different times, the angel would come down and trouble the water, and somebody would walk away with the miracle. I believe that this pool of Bethesda, that while it was open for business, it probably had quite a crowd that was there. But when you think about the crowd that would have been at the pool of Bethesda, you would have, when you read what in verse 3, he says that all these folks, they all had all their different ailments. They was blind that was there. The halt was there. The withered was there. I believe there was just, when you looked around, it was just a bunch of people that was in great need. Nobody, there was no way that, I mean, you couldn't describe the sadness. You couldn't describe the sickness. You can't describe the scene of all of these people that was gathered around the pool of Bethesda waiting for an angel to come down and trouble the water. All of these sick folk that were there, every one of them with some various need in their life, and just with the hope that they would be the first one to get in and to be healed in that water after it had been troubled by the angel. Man, when you think about it, this pool of Bethesda, it had a wonderful story. An angel troubled the water.
Yeah.
An angel troubles the water. I mean, man, you think about it. Who don't want to come and see? And I don't know how it happened. I don't know. I'm just taking the Bible for what it says.
Right.
That the angel troubled the waters.
Right.
Yes.
And I don't know if it was just that there was such a just a troubling and a splashing and a stirring, but what we do know, amen, is that everybody that was there realized that something was going on, that something was taking place, and that they realized enough that even this man, this impotent man, realized that, you know what, I need to get into the water. And he realized that when it's troubled, I don't have anybody to take me. And I can't get there. When somebody gets there before me. And I mean, it's just, you know, but that whatever took place, they knew that there was a troubling. They knew that there was a moving. They knew that right then, I don't know if it was just some miraculous thing and that was taking place or whatever, but obvious, they knew that something was going on. They needed to get into the water, amen, so that they could receive a miracle for themselves.
Amen. Yes.
It was occasional that it would take place.
Yes. Right.
It was only at a season.
Right.
At a certain season, just randomly, without any indication, without any notice, without any pre-announcement.
Yes.
It would just happen.
Right. Yes.
And if you would just happen to be close to the water at that time, man, it was your good day, your good fortune.
Amen.
For you to get in and to get into troubled water and get your miracle. It was just occasionally that it would happen. Uh-huh. Maybe it would go for days without the angel trouble. I don't know, maybe weeks. I don't know, maybe it was months. Maybe there was a great amount of time between us. We don't know that, but it was just occasionally that it would happen.
Yeah.
But yet it would happen enough that it would keep these sick people, all these different people, looking on with anxious and with belief and with faith and hope that it would be trouble today and that they could get their miracle and that they could leave that house of mercy.
Yes.
Just occasionally. You know, it was extremely limited.
Yes, it was.
One person.
Yeah.
Right.
One person.
Yes.
The first one to get into the water would receive the touch.
Right.
It was very discriminating. I mean, it was just that first person. It was, if you were just a little bit behind, you didn't get half healed. If you were just a few seconds behind the first one,
right,
you didn't get a little bit of a healing.
Right.
It was just for the first one to get in.
Right.
The first one into the troubled waters is the one that received the miracle.
Yes.
And when you think about it, all those sitting there, and they think, I've got to be the first one.
Right.
I can't be it. I can't be the second.
Right.
I can't be the third. I have to be the first one.
Amen.
Into the pool to have my need met. Hallelujah.
Oh, yes.
Notice it was all to all these people. All these people, but yet they were close, but yet it was as if they were far away.
Right.
For this impotent man, he had been there in this condition for 38 years.
Wow.
And here he had been close. He had been near the pool.
Right.
He had been in the house of mercy.
Yes, right.
But yet he had not been close enough that he could give his miracle.
Right. Yeah.
How many times did he leave disappointed?
Yes.
How many times was he disappointed that here I've been here all this time?
Right.
I've been here longer than all these other people.
Yeah.
I've been suffering more than all those other people.
Right.
But yet here I am at time after time. And yet my need is not met.
Right.
Amen.
Right, kind of discouraging, don't you think?
Right. Yes,
it was. And a little bit discouraging.
Oh, yes.
The pool of Bethesda. And I think it was probably, you know, I think the pool of Bethesda is just, it's just so symbolic of the mercy of God.
Yes, it is.
That God has a heart of compassion, a God of mercy,
yes.
And that he wants to touch people. I could see having God coming down and doing something miraculous like that, because I know that God is a God of compassion and mercy.
Yes, amen.
That he wants to do that.
Right.
But for what I, but you know what, you would think something so spectacular, something so wonderful.
Why?
Yeah. Would it go out of business?
Yes.
Why would it go out of business?
Yes.
Why do you think that it would still be operational today? You'd think that, man, they would do all that they could to maintain something like that. I mean, that's better than some hospitals you go into. Right? I mean, you'd think they would have done all of that. You'd think they'd have built a shrine around it. You'd think that they would have built a cathedral over it. You would have thought that they would have went to great lengths to maintain and to keep this.
Yes.
What happened?
Right.
Why would the pool of Bethesda go out of business?
Right.
I can't imagine that.
Right.
Then why somebody, well, all those people, I hear, well, the pool shut down today. Oh, you're kidding me. Man, I got a miracle there. Man, I can't believe that. I wonder why that closed down. Yeah, the pool of Bethesda, they closed it down today. Going out of business. Why? What's going on? Not enough sick folk, I guess. Not enough people in needs, I guess. It's closing down. It's going out of business.
Wow.
You're kidding me. Man, I remember my buddy Fred. Man, he got a miracle there. He was a withered guy. He got into the pool after it was troubled. Man, and he came out there healed. And man, he know what? He came out there just 100%. It was a miracle. Uh-huh. It's going out of business, you say, huh? Going out of business. I don't know what kind of going out of business sale the pool of Bethesda would have. Sell little bottles of water in the pool of Bethesda. I don't know. What happened? You know, you look around and there's a lot of things in life that have gone out of business.
Sure, right?
A lot of businesses that really, in their time, they were successful.
Yes.
They could kind of fit in and they had a little niche that they provided some service or did something that was needful.
Yes.
And you would think that some businesses, well, they'll be around forever.
Uh-huh.
They'll be around forever. You know, like the people that make phone booths. That's a great service. That's a tremendous thing. And you know what? Surely there'll always be a need for people to make a phone booth. Right? Surely there'll always be a need for somebody. Amen. They need to make a call at a spur of a moment. Somebody that'll need to make a call and call some relative, and they're going to need a phone. There'll always be a need for a phone booth. But guess what? Something better than a phone booth came along.
Right.
It's called a cell phone.
Right.
That everybody from 80 years old all the way down to 8 years old. Amen. They've all got a cell phone. Amen. First graders asking for a cell phone. They want a cell phone. I mean, you know why? And guess what? When was the last time you saw a phone booth? Wow. Tell you where I found one. I don't know if it's still there, but down in Russellville, Arkansas, outside the campground, Brother Jamie. Amen. There was still a phone booth out there just a couple of years ago, all right? Just a couple of years ago, because there was no cell signal out there, so they had a phone booth, all right? But I don't know. Maybe they put a tower up now. They don't need the phone booth anymore. But that's the last one I've seen. You don't see those very often unless you're in an antique store, all right? And they're probably not operational. Why? Something better came along than a phone booth.
Yeah.
Right? Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
Something better came along than a phone booth.
Uh-huh.
Well, guess what? Amen. Something better than Bethesda came along.
Amen.
Something better than Bethesda came along. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know about you, but something happened. Amen. That put Bethesda out of business. It put it out of business. And I'll tell you what it was. What I believe it was, all right? Amen. And what I believe it was that put Bethesda out of business because there was something better than Bethesda. Tell you what I believe it was. You might have a different idea.
Have your way, Lord.
But I tell you, I think it was Pentecost.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
That's right.
Praise.
I think it was the day of Pentecost.
Praise.
I think Pentecost was better than the pool.
Yes.
And so, guess what? Since something better than Bethesda came along, amen, it put it out of business. You say, well, what are you talking about? Amen, on the day of Pentecost, when the disciples were in an upper room and they were empowered by the Holy Ghost,
right,
and the Spirit of God came down upon them,
right,
amen, and the Holy Ghost gave them the power of the Spirit of God to dwell inside of them. Amen, it was something much better than the pool of Bethesda. Why, we heard that, well, you know that lame man. sits at the gate beautiful.
Yes, amen.
That has sat there every day. Did you hear about him? Well, these two guys, I think, I don't know, Peter, I think you know what I'm talking about. Those guys, they were coming into the temple at the hour of prayer. And that lame man who's been there all that time was sitting out in the gate begging alms. And he asked of them alms. And those guys stopped and they said, man, silver and gold, we don't have any of that, but such as we have, give I thee in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And they said, immediately his ankle wounds received strength and he leaped to his feet. And they saw him running, leaping, dancing into the temple and praising God. I hear the Bethesda business group right now, the ownership group, man, oh, you're kidding me. Oh, you're kidding me. Man, you're kidding. Is everything good? Man, it was a miracle. And he's been seen walking all over town. Walking over to, well, they probably explained it away. They probably said, well, you know what? That was just one incident. That's just one person.
Right.
We, you know, probably it's not nothing for us to worry about. Probably not nothing for us to worry about. But as things begin to progress, you read that these disciples that have been empowered by the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Right. Amen.
And that wherever they went,
yes.
Amen, signs and wonders were following them.
Amen.
Amen. The miracles were happening. In Acts chapter 5, it says, and by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders brought. Among the people.
Yes.
And they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch.
Huh.
Wow, not five porches, but Solomon's porch. Yes. Amen. It goes down and says, and believers were more added to the Lord, multitudes, both of men and women, in so much that they brought forth the sick. Will tell you that.
Yes.
Matter of fact, you can Google it and see the picture. All right?
Right.
But they will tell you that it's out of business.
Yes.
It's not operational anymore. But I want you to know that there's still a lot of sick people.
Right.
Still a lot of needy people.
Come on. Yes, there is.
There's still people, and I look around in here tonight, and there's people here in this building that have needs in their life. Pentecost. Never went out of business. Hallelujah. While there came along something better than Bethesda, there's never come along anything better. Amen. Than the church. Hallelujah. Nothing better than the power of the Spirit of God. Amen. Nothing better, amen, than believing and putting faith in God. Amen. To believe that God can touch and meet our need. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Oh,
that's hallelujah.
Glory to God.
I'm glad we're not sitting here tonight.
Oh, do it, Lord. Do it, Lord.
Waiting around.
Yes.
Amen.
Right.
A little kiddie pool.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
Waiting.
Right.
Hoping.
Oh,
that tonight, maybe, guess what? Tonight, maybe the Lord will move and the water will get troubled.
Glory.
Man, I'll tell you what, man, you know, Lorenzo, Lee, they would be in a good spot. But if we were depending on that water, amen, you know what, Brother Chris, man, he just wouldn't stand much of a chance. He just wouldn't, and I'm telling you, Brother Trey, all the way back to the back, brother, I'm afraid you're going to go home with the same need that you came with. I believe, you know what, I don't think you're going to fight, because guess what, that little cooled up here. Hey man, that little thing, well, aren't you glad that we don't have to wait and hope and just think that, man, just one person? Hey man, it's not like the lottery, you know, just one person. Hey man, I want you to know the Spirit of God. Hey man, can come in this place tonight. Hey man, he can move on every one of our needs. Hey man, not just one of us go home. Hey man, let every one of us go home with our need met in our life. For those just sitting in the front. Amen. Would it be for all those? But aren't you glad that the Holy Spirit can move on the front seat and he can also move on the back seat? Hallelujah. He can move from one side all the way to the other side. Amen. I believe that Pentecost is so much better than a pool. Amen. I believe that Pentecost is so much better than the pool. Amen. That we can believe that God can come down in this place and the Holy Ghost can come down and move on. I believe. Amen. That the Lord can move for us tonight.
Amen.
And that somebody can walk out of here. Amen. With the touch of God. Hallelujah. Would you stand with me tonight?
Hallelujah.
Our God, he's a marvelous God. And I'm thankful for the Holy Spirit. Thankful for the Holy Ghost. The power of God. Because I believe the power of God can do the miraculous.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Tell you what. As long as the Spirit of God is moving in the church, church will never go out of business.
Amen.
As long as we let the Spirit of God move in our lives, church will never go out of business.
No, that's right.
As long as you have faith to believe. Amen. Then God will move on your knee.
Yes, He will.
You know, that's something that fascinated me when I read John chapter 5.
Hallelujah.
That these people could put their faith in a random, uncertain event.
Yeah, right.
That they can put their faith in that, to believe in it.
Yes.
To believe in it. That this lame man, he believed it with all of his heart.
Yes, he did.
That, man, if I could just get there.
Yes.
If I could be the first.
Right.
Now, if we could just get that faith.
Oh, thank you, God.
In this church house tonight.
Oh,
if we could just get that faith in our heart,
yes,
to believe that it's not just one, but if I could, it's like the woman with the issue of blood. If I could just touch him,
yes.
If I could just reach out, yes. Amen. You don't have to worry about somebody else getting the blessing before you.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I believe that we could all leave here tonight receiving what we need from the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What I'd like for us to do tonight, amen, we're just going to have, if it's all right, we're just going to have time. We're going to have a prayer meeting tonight, all right? Amen. Because I believe the Spirit of the Lord, and I'd like to see somebody leave here with a touch of their life. Amen. I believe God would like to come down, and the Spirit of God would like to come down and touch somebody's life tonight. Hallelujah. And maybe it's your opportunity tonight. Maybe you've got the faith to believe. You know what? Amen. I believe that God can touch me. Amen. I believe that the Spirit of God can move in here and I can lead with my touch in my life tonight. Hallelujah. And if you've got a need tonight, would you come and stand in the front of this church? Amen. If you've got a need, I just want you to come and stand right now in the front of this church, all right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. And you know what? Sister Emily is singing that song. I always like that song. I think Rodney Griffin wrote that song. And I believe that those words in that song. Man, you know, did you see the lame man rush past here? Did you see? You know, if you don't believe it, just ask the blind guy. He saw everything.
Yeah.
But that those words are just so amazing to me. Developed an issue with his vocal cords, and his voice had just become a raspy, you could hardly hear him at all. He could barely talk, just a raspy voice, so low. He had to retire from the ministry. He had to leave his post prematurely and go and just sit in the church. They arranged for him to have a microphone that would hook to his neck, that would sit on his chin, and then they could hear him as he taught the Sunday school lesson. One Sunday morning, he came in, began to teach his Sunday school lesson. He was teaching about healing. Teaching about healing and talking in his raspy voice that was, it's just so hard to hear. And as he was talking and talking about, he came across the word and he said the word life. And when he said the word life, instantly, it was like his voice changed and it went perfectly normal. It stunned him, so he stopped. Had to think, was that me? Did I just speak that word? He went back to repeat himself. And when he went back to repeat what he had said previously, he said it in a perfectly need a touch tonight. They're believing God for something in their life. Amen. Church, I want you to come. I want you to gather behind them, around them, surround them. Amen. And let's pray. Amen. That God would come by and touch them. Amen. Let's pray. Amen. That Pentecost would happen in this place. Let's pray that the power of Pentecost